All right, so we'll start off this section with a fairly straightforward question. If we were told that the derivative of a function was 5x to the fourth plus x, then what is the function? So think about this for a minute, pause maybe, and see if you can answer this on your own. All right, so if this is the derivative of a function, well, let's see, how would we get the 5x to the fourth? Think a little bit of that, through this, and we could say, well, then the function must have had an x to the fifth, because the derivative of x to the fifth is 5x to the fourth. And let's see, then plus x. Well, to get the x, we'd have to have an x square term. But if we took the derivative of x squared, then we'd have a 2x, so we'd have to fix it a little bit. So how about plus 1 half x squared? The derivative of 1 half x squared is 1 half times 2x is x. And so maybe you wrote this. Well, yeah, that'll work. But this will also work. What if I said plus 9? X to the fifth plus 1 half x squared plus 9, the derivative of this function is also 5x to the 4th plus x. Or how about the function f of x is x to the 5th plus 1 half x squared minus 74. Its derivative is also 5x to the 4th plus x. And in fact, we can say generally the function can take a form x to the 5th plus 1 half x squared plus some constant, right, where c is a constant. And so what we would say is, and what this is, what we're going about here is, that this x to the fifth plus 1 half x squared plus c, this is the antiderivative of 5x to the 4th plus x. Right? So if we're given the derivative, we can find its antiderivative, hopefully. And so now we have a special symbol for this concept. And so let's introduce that symbol and talk a little bit about that symbol. So we have a special notation for this concept. We call this the indefinite integral. And now later on, we'll talk about what we mean by the definite integral. But the notation that's come about is called the indefinite integral. And so we would say is the integral, that's what this symbol is, that long looking S shape, the integral of 5x to the fourth plus x dx, and that dx is important, we'll talk about that in a moment. We would say that the integral of 5x to the fourth plus x dx is x to the fifth plus 1 half x squared plus c. Alright, so some notation. That symbol that's called the integral symbol the 5x to the 4th plus x in this case, right? In this case, that expression, in this case, the 5x to the 4th plus x, that's called the integrand. And then the dx, right? In this case, the dx, this is called the differential. And we learned a little bit about differentials in a previous topic. We're going to learn more about differentials in this section. And so then, in general, if we're given some f of x, given the function f of x, an antiderivative of f of x is any function, capital F of x, such that f prime of x is f of x. Such that if we take the derivative of big F of x, we get back the integrand, the f of x. All right, and so if f of x is any antiderivative of f of x, then the most general antiderivative of little f of x is called the indefinite integral of little f of x, and denoted like this. The integral of little f of x dx is f capital F of x plus a constant, the general antiderivative plus c. Now, this differential, that dx, is required, and it does two really important things. One, it tells us where the integral ends. So this dx up here, right, we had this integral of 5x to the fourth plus x dx. That tells me I'm integrating everything between the integral symbol and the dx. So I'm integrating the entire 5x to the fourth plus x. Second, it tells us what we're thinking of as our independent variable. And so we won't concern ourselves with this too much right now, but just for a basic concept, we've seen that this integral, 5x to the fourth plus x dx, so now I'm integrating with respect to x. And so then I have to think of the x here, right? I have to think of this x as a variable. And so then, if I'm integrating with respect to that variable, we get the result that we've seen so far, the x to the fifth plus 1 half x squared plus c. If, however, I was integrating with respect to some other variable, let's say I was integrating 5x to the fourth plus x dy, now y is my independent variable, and see, everything inside here, there's no y variable, and so since there's no y variable here, I can think of this 5x to the fourth plus x as being constant in terms of y. And so then the antiderivative would be something different than this, than the previous example. And so I'm not gonna fully go through this one, because this is something that's more that you'll see more in a later course. And it becomes important in a later course, but we have to be careful about matching that the variable in our integrand and our differential match, unless it's very clear that they shouldn't match. And that's more for a later course. So now, let's go over a brief table of antiderivatives. These are results that we should recognize from the derivative rules that we know in the past. So for example, if we had the integral of x to the n dx, now again, dx, so x is the variable, right? Dx, x is the variable. And so if we think about this, this is like the power rule for derivatives. Now for the power rule for derivatives, we could bring the coefficient in front and decrease the exponent by 1. Well, to undo that, we would have to increase the exponent by 1 and divide by that new exponent. And then the most general antiderivative would have a plus c. Now, quickly, we notice that this will not work for a certain value of n. We can clearly see that this doesn't work if n is negative 1, so we must say that this formula is only valid if n is not equal to negative 1. Now that case where n equals negative 1, that's a special case, and maybe you can think of the result if n equals negative 1 based on what you've learned in the past, but we'll see that in the next slide. Alright, so let's think of it this one. The antiderivative, the integral of 0 dx. Alright, so if the derivative was 0, the antiderivative, the original function, must have been just a constant. The derivative of a constant is 0. The antiderivative of 0 is a constant. What if we had the antiderivative? What's the integral of a constant? Well, let's see. If the derivative was constant, then the original function must have been a linear function. It must have been kx plus c. What's the antiderivative? What's the integral of cosine x? All right, so if the derivative was cosine, the antiderivative, undoing that, would have been the sine function. The derivative of the sine function is the cosine function. The antiderivative of the sine function. Now here we got to be careful. I know that the derivative of the cosine is negative sine. So if I wanted positive sine as the derivative, I must have started with negative cosine. The antiderivative, the integral of the secant square x, we should hopefully recognize that as being tangent x. The derivative of cosecant square x. All right, well, I know that the derivative of the cotangent function is negative cosecant square. So again, I have to use that sort of negative concept. It must be negative cotangent x plus a constant. The integral of secant x tangent x dx, we recognize that as being the derivative of secant x. The integral of cosecant x cotangent x, we hopefully recognize that as being the opposite of the derivative of the cosecant function. Okay, so there's our first part, our first brief table. All right, second, e to the x. We know that the derivative of e to the x is e to the x, so it should seem reasonable that the antiderivative of e to the x is also e to the x plus a constant. A to the x. Now this one's a little different. Remember, a to the x is our more general rule, and we learned that the derivative of a to the x was a to the x times the natural log of a. So to undo that, we would have a to the x divided by the natural log of a. Again, plus a constant. All right, so now if we go back to the previous slide for a moment, we said, well, our general rule for x to the n was that it was x to the n plus 1 divided by n plus 1. But we immediately said, hey, that can't work, because if n was negative 1, we'd have a 0 in the denominator, it becomes undefined. So now, what about that situation? Well, remember that x to the negative 1 is the same as writing, this is the same as writing the integral of 1 over x dx. And so hopefully you see that and you say, well, wait a second. I know that the derivative of the natural log function is 1 over x. And so then the antiderivative 1 over x should be the natural log function. And it is, with one change. If we think about the natural log function, its domain is only the positive numbers. We can extend the domain of the integral of 1 over x dx, writing it like this, natural log absolute x plus a constant. And so this extends, because if we think the domain of x to the negative first power is just, it's all real numbers except 0, so the antiderivative should have that same domain. The antiderivative natural log of absolute x now has that same domain. Now I can put in everything except 0. Now, if we wanted to find the antiderivative of the natural log function, this is tough. Well, for now it's tough. We see this in Calc 2. All right, we don't know how to do this just yet. It requires a particular technique that we learn in Calc 2. The hyperbolic sine. Well, the hyperbolic sine and cosine behave nicely, right? The derivative of the hyperbolic sine is the hyperbolic cosine, and vice versa. There's no negatives to worry about here. So the integral of sinh x is cosh x plus a constant. The integral of cosh x is sinh x plus a constant. The integral of 1 over 1 minus the square root of 1 minus x squared dx, you hopefully recognize that as being an inverse trig function. And so this is the inverse sine of x plus a constant, or the alternate notation, right, the arcsine of x plus a constant. Similarly, the integral of 1 over 1 plus x squared dx is the inverse tangent function, or the arctan. So these two tables, these last two pages, you need to memorize these. These are things you should know. You don't want to have to look back on a table every time one of these comes up. You need to know these forms. You'll need to know them in Calc 2. You'll need to know them in Calc 3. You'll need to know them in differential equations. You'll need to know them in any course that involves calculus beyond this course. Just like you needed to know the derivative rules. These are the most common functions that we need to integrate. Actually, there's a few others that we learn about in Calc 2. And so you want to be able to recognize these forms and be able to just know them right away. Now we have a couple of basic properties and important properties. If we need to find the integral of some constant times a function, constants being multiplied by functions behave nicely with integrals. This is the same as k times the integral of f of x dx. And so then if we know that antiderivative, then that's k capital f of x plus a constant. All right, so multiplying by a constant in the integrand, we can take it outside the integrand, it behaves nicely. Similarly, if we are required to find the integral of a sum or difference of functions, we can break that up into multiple terms. So then this would be the integral of f of x dx plus or minus, as appropriate, the integral of g of x dx. Notice how the differential is brought to each term and the integral is brought to each term. And so then again, if we know the antiderivatives, we can then think of this as capital F of x up. And now capital F of x, that would have a constant, let's call it c1, plus or minus capital G of x, if we assume that capital G is the antiderivative of little g, plus a constant. And so then, now C1 plus C2, if both of those are constants, then their sum is a constant. And so we would write then that this is capital F of x plus or minus, as appropriate, capital G of x plus just a single constant, C. All right, so those are the basic concepts and some basic properties. So I'm going to stop this video here, and in the next video, we're going to start seeing some examples.